Luncheon, just retired as a long-standing health system CEO. And he made what I thought was a comment that was brilliant in its simplicity. And he basically said, we always need to be mindful that there's a distinct difference between the business that we're in and the work that we do. So when you think about the mission of our organization, it's to heal, to teach, and to discover, and we take care of people who come to us during the most vulnerable time of their lives. And that is the work that we do. But today, I'll talk mostly about the business that we're in, because when you think about healthcare on a national basis, it now accounts for about $2.5 trillion. It's now about one out of every $6 that we spend. And if there's one common theme among all of us in this room, more than likely we are all going to need healthcare at some point in our lives. And so we treat the work that we do and the business that we're in as a public trust at university hospitals, and we're very proud of our commitment to the community. So let me talk a little bit about the work that we've done in the area of, I guess specifically, the Vision 2010 program that Dan referenced. We're now recently have the last of our announcements and openings of the Center for Emergency Medicine at Case Medical Center. But over the past 5 years, with Mike Foyer, who is a very dedicated and engaged board member, our board had the foresight and the vision to really realize that we needed to make a big difference in the communities that we serve in a broader scale than we had previously. So we went through our business planning processes, and if you believe in the adage that demographics is destiny, we monitor very carefully population demographics and so forth, think about where patient populations and where our patients are coming from. So we embarked on something called Vision 2010, which was a $1.2 billion program that included the construction of a number of things here in emergency hospital. I won't go through an exhaustive list, but it included some new medical office buildings, it included 4 new ambulatory centers and a broader geographic presence than we had before. It includes, as Dan mentioned, the new cancer hospital, the Seidman Cancer Center, named after Jamie Lee Seidman, who gave us a $42 million gift in which to name our cancer service line after them and their families. It includes the new Luncheon Medical Center, as referenced, which is literally pretty much right across the street from where we are today. We renovated our neonatal intensive care unit, which by many measures, objective measures, is among the best neonatal intensive care units in the world. And as well, we invested in other programs and services. And tying it all together, you might not have picked it up in Dan's comment, but one thing that you don't ever see, but that is critically important, is we've now spent about $140 million on the creation of an integrated electronic health record. And it sounds rather simple to have one patient and one record, but it cost us about $140 million to date to get there. But it's critically important because although we can talk about buildings and programs and services, what really weaves all of this together is information technology and our ability to have one patient, one record that's accessible to our patients from through a secure website from any location in the world by either themselves or from the caregiver. So this is something we feel particularly proud of. There are less than 5% of the hospitals that have a truly integrated electronic health record. So to the question, just to give you a little bit of framework, so to answer the question directly, when we embarked on Vision 2010, we thought it was critically important to make sure that we were going to be focusing on the communities that we serve in a whole variety of ways. And I will just give you a few examples of that. So here's what we've done. We made the commitment back in 2005, Vision 2010 was a 5-year plan. We made the commitment back in 2005 that we would put together a plan where 5% of our spend on Vision 2010 would be toward female or women business enterprises. 15% would be on minority spend. 20%, and 80% rather, would be a local spend. And meaning that we wanted to work with local firms, local companies. And so we didn't have to do this. This was something we committed to the mayor to do. But as well, we want to make sure that we're not only good business partners, but by many measures, good neighbors. And so now that Vision 2010 is winding down, I'm pleased to say that we committed 5% for female business enterprises. We actually came in at about 7.5%. We committed 15% would be minority business enterprise spend, and that number is actually 22%. And we committed that 80% of our spend would be local, meaning that people had to have a local presence. If they didn't, and they were interested in business, they had to move their business here. And we committed to 80%, and 92% of our spend has been local. So I hope, frankly, that we thank is from my board and from my own personal and professional perspective, to make sure that we have very strong moral compass and that what we're going to do not only is, we're not only going to do what's great for the patients we serve, which of course we do every day and earn our quality recognition, but as well to be an important member of this community and specifically an important member of the business community. So let me kind of set the stage for some of your future questions.
Absolutely. When you guys were going through and setting up your 2010 plan, how did you decide, why was it so important for you to have such a large percentage of your spend locally and to support female minority businesses in town?
Well, there's a senior person on our team by the name of Steve Stanley, and this was something that Steve was particularly passionate about. We were committed to do this as a board and as a senior leadership team, and frankly, as our entire organization. The reason why we found it to be important is, remember, we live in not one of the most rapidly growing population regions, nor one of the most robust business communities in the United States. So we wanted to make certain that we were going to be helping all of those who would have the opportunity to work on a project who might not otherwise be able to do so. So, for example, when we put together the relationship that we wanted to create with minority business enterprises, we also formed a relationship where we created a project labor agreement. Now, we actually have, I think, four writers who are with us now from Harvard, who are actually going to be putting this together in the form of a case presentation. Because when we created this project labor agreement, we worked with the local unions to make certain that there would be no strike clause in the contract, that no matter what happened on a national basis, all the locals would continue working on our project. Likewise, we made it a point that there would have to be participation from the local vocational technical schools, so we had a number of students who worked on projects who wanted to be either architects, engineers, or mechanics. And as well, we have a volunteer program where all of our contractors participate in the ability for these students to work on our project in somewhat of a paid position, but mostly from an educational perspective. And then probably most importantly, we just again thought that this was critically important for our local economy to benefit from the things that we were going to be doing, that we are going to be doing in the future. So I'm not at liberty to discuss exactly what we're doing right now, but we're also working to make certain that a number of our vendors who may have off-site, for example, warehousing, distribution, supply chain components, we do a lot of our purchases on a national contracting basis, that if they do have a distribution center, we're actually requiring a number of people to move here to what he's done, because we want to make sure that we are going to be supporting the growth and development of job opportunities here. And so the project labor agreement, working with students, working with minority contractors, and one of the things that we did, for example, in the minority arena was that it's very difficult for small or smaller contractors to be able to get bonded on that project, and we required all of our contractors to be bonded. So what we were able to do was to create an opportunity for them to be bonded through working with the larger construction companies who work on a particular project. So this extends everything from labor, construction, architects, engineers, mechanics, everything. We want to make sure that we were going to be doing everything that we